Namaste everyone, I welcome you to my channel Pratibha with Bad Technology. Today my lecture topic is on in vitro production of secondary metabolite. This is very important unit under plant biotechnology, so kindly focus on this. Okay, the plant body is made up of organic molecules belonging to different groups of compounds like proteins, lipids, nucleic acids, carbohydrates, alcohols, vitamins, proteins, fats, etc. The reaction pathways involving the synthesis and degradation of all these components are collectively known as primary metabolism, and the individual components which are referred to as primary metabolites. Okay, here primary metabolism and their individual components are known as primary metabolites. However, there are several other chemical components which are not directly involved in primary metabolism and are synthesized for various other purposes. The components of the primary metabolic pathways serves as a source for the synthesis of chemical compounds called secondary metabolites. Secondary metabolites may be involved in differentiation of cells and tissues. They also defense against pathogens and herbivores or as the chemical agents for the reaction of plants with the organisms. They may be always present in the plant body or they are synthesized at particular developmental stages. They are also synthesized in plant cells as products of interaction with the environment. Okay, as I'm dealing here the secondary metabolites under plant biotechnology, so can say here the secondary metabolites are synthesized by plant cells, and even the secondary metabolites also synthesized in bacteria and also from fungi. The metabolism can be defined as the sum of all the biochemical reactions carried out by an organism. Metabolites are the intermediates and products of metabolism, right? A primary metabolite is a kind of metabolite that is directly involved in normal growth, development and reproduction. Why this particular point mentioned here? Only primary metabolites play very important role during the metabolic pathway, whereas secondary metabolites are not at all involved in the growth and development. Okay, secondary metabolites are organic compounds produced by bacteria, fungi or plants which are not directly involved in normal growth, development or reproduction of the organism. Okay. There are five main classes of secondary metabolites such as terpenoids and steroids, fatty acids, derived substances and polyketides, alkaloids, non-ribosomal polypeptides and enzyme cofactor. Now let us go through the functions of secondary metabolites. The major functions of the secondary metabolites including antibiotics are competitive weapons against other living such as animals, plants, insects and microorganisms. Metal transporting agents, agents for symbiotic relationship with other organisms. Reproductive agent and also differentiation effectors and agents of communication between organisms. Secondary metabolites belong to different groups of organic compounds and they are involved in various functions such as flower pigments, example anthocyanin or flavonoids, fruit pigments, isoflavones, anthocyanin, allopathic agents, quinones, tannins, flavones. Here allopathic agents means it is a biological phenomenon by which an organism produces one or more biochemicals that influence the germination, growth, survival and reproduction. Okay, feeding deterrents against insects. Example, quinones, tannins, flavones. Here feeding deterrents means a plant compound or substances that hinders a pest from subsequent food intake after an initial tasting. Here next example of the secondary metabolites with the functions. Phytoalexins, example, phenanthrins, fluorocoumarins. Okay, here the phytoalexin means a substance that is produced by plant tissues in response to contact with a parasite and specifically inhibits the growth of the parasite. That was the function, that is nothing but phytoalexins. The last one is antifungal agents, for example, isoflavones, phenolic compounds. Okay, here you could see the uses of secondary metabolites. The first column alkaloid, second column plant system, then part of the plant, then uses or application of that particular alkaloid. The first alkaloid taken here, quinine. This quinine, which is obtained from the plant system, that is Cinchona officinalis, from this particular plant system, bark was taken from the bark. Quinine was alkaloid was extracted, right? And that uses worked as an anti-malarial drug. Like that, some other alkaloids like nicotine, morphine, cocaine, and rizepine, caffeine, nimbine, and scopolamine, then pyrethroids. These are some of the applications of secondary metabolites with the respective alkaloids. Now here one more table which is representing the medical use of some specific alkaloids and their mechanism of action. For example, here vinblastine, which play medical role in breast cancer, then lymphoma, then germ cell and renal cancer. Mechanism of action, this inhibits the cell proliferation by acting as mitotic block. Okay, if you want this particular information, if you want to go through, kindly you can pause the video or you can take a screenshot and you can study. Secondary metabolites cannot be directly isolated from plants because the plant may not be available in required quantity for commercial exploitation, right? This is one of the major critical condition. The natural level of secondary metabolites is very low, right? So the culture techniques are used in order to isolate secondary metabolites, to obtain more amount of secondary metabolites and also to fulfill the society and the demand. We are depending on the culture techniques, that is plant tissue culture condition, that is in vitro techniques we are depending to obtain this particular secondary metabolites. Tissue differentiation is very important for secondary metabolites production. For example, quinine is isolated from the bark of Cinchona trees. Monoterpenes are isolated from glandular hair of Pelagium fragrans. The process of in vitro culture of cells for large production of secondary metabolites is quite complex and involves the following aspects. First one, selection of cell lines for high yield of secondary metabolites. Large scale cultivation of plant cells. Medium composition and effect of nutrients. Elicitor, induced portion of secondary metabolites. Effect of environmental factors. Biotransformation using plant cell cultures. Then the last one is secondary metabolite release and analysis. Today in my video session, only few I'll be able to explain. In detail, we'll go through in some other video. Okay, now let us go through cell aggregate cloning, which is one of the process of in vitro culture of cells. It involves the selection of cell lines producing high amount of secondary metabolites. And this particular technique is a simple method, involves growth of single cells in a suitable medium. It permits the identification of cells with increased biosynthetic activity. Okay, some special techniques have been devised to select cell lines for the production of secondary metabolites that can produce higher amounts of desired metabolites. These methods are ultimately useful for the separation of producer cells from the non-producer cells. The techniques commonly employed for the cell line selection are cell cloning and visual or chemical analysis, and also selection for resistance. Visual analysis means it is applicable when the compound is colored. Then the next one, selection for resistance means the cells which are resistant to toxic compounds forms mutant cells. Such cells can be used here. Okay. For the production of secondary metabolites, first and foremost important thing is that one has to select high plant yielding variety. From that plant, one has to select the X plant. Then that further will be subjected for the callus, cell suspension, then cell aggregation, then culturing system, quantitative analysis, subculture, then selection of the good subcultured cells, then scale up of suspension culture, then at the end, for the large scale production, that will be subjected for the bioreactor. Why do plants produce secondary metabolites? Based on the existing evidence, it is believed that the production of some secondary metabolites is linked to the induction of morphological differentiation. Okay, I'll repeat for you. Why this plant produce secondary metabolites means, based on the existing evidence what we are getting here, we are believing that the production of secondary metabolites is linked to the induction of morphological differentiation of the plant system. So you can see some of the examples. The cardiac glycosides are found in the leaves of digitalis. Quinine and quinidine are present in the bark of cinchona. Tropane alkaloids, for example atropine, are found in the roots of atropa. It appears that all the cells undergo morphological differentiation and maturation during plant growth, and also some of the cells specialize to promote secondary metabolites. It is also observed that the in vitro production of secondary metabolites is much higher from differentiated tissues when compared to non-differentiated or less differentiated tissues. Then coming to the advantages using plant tissue culture. Compounds can be produced under controlled conditions as per market demands. Culture systems are independent of environmental factors, seasonal variation, pest microbial diseases, geographical variations, etc. Cell growth can be controlled to produce improved products formation. Quality of the products will be consistent as it is produced by a specific cell line. Recovery of the product will be very easy. Plant culture are particularly useful in case of plant which are difficult to be grown in fields. Mutant cell lines can be developed for the production of novel compounds of commercial importance which are normally not found in plants. Production time is less and labor costs are minimal. Approximately 25 to 30% of medicines for human use and various chemical materials are obtained from plant tissue culture. Now, factors affecting in vitro production of secondary metabolites. Secondary metabolites production can be enhanced by altering the nutrients. For example, when phosphate was added to cultures of Marengo citrifolia, there was 50% increase in accumulation of anthraquinone. Concentration of growth regulators also matters. For example, when 2,4-D treated, that 2,4-D causes cell expansion and growth, but it also suppresses the secondary metabolite production. Influence of precursors on addition of biosynthetic intermediates increases the accumulation of secondary metabolites. For example, when tyrosine is added to the cultures of Chinopodium, it triples the accumulation of beta-cyanin. Okay, next. Production condition which includes nutrient availability, biotic and abiotic factors, pH, degree of mixing, the chemicals, internal culture conditions, etc. Influence of elicitors. Phytoalexins are chemical compounds produced by the plants in response to pathogens for defense. Substances which act as stimulants for reproduction of phytoalkanes are known as elicitors. For example, glucomannose, glucans and chitosans. In the exam, you may get the question like, what are elicitors? The molecules that stimulate the production of secondary metabolites are called elicitors. There are three ways of production of secondary metabolites or plant tissue culture, which are as follows. First one, cell suspension culture, hairy root culture, immobilized cell culture. Cell suspension cultures. Mostly in production of secondary metabolite, we follow cell suspension culture, which is more suitable and convenient technique to handle. Some of the stages as follows. Selection of suitable cell and callus formation. The first step in plant tissue culture is to develop a callus culture from the whole plant. For this purpose, we should select a cell having ability to generate a whole plant cells. Such cells are known as totipotent cells, or total potentiality to regenerate into entire plantlet or whole plantlet, known as totipotent. Every cell, tissues, organs in plant system, we can observe the totipotency characteristics. An undifferentiated mass of cells on culture plate is known as callus. A callus must be obtained from a totipotent dividing cells. Development of cell suspension culture. The important factor count in culturing cells is precise, good and sterilized medium. A suspension culture is developed by transferring small amount of a callus into liquid medium and is maintained under suitable conditions of aeration, agitation, light, temperature and other physical factors. So all these parameters play a very important role during cell suspension culture development. Agitation and suspension culture can be brought by incubating on rotary shaker at 100 rpm rotation per minute, and also for agitation under the dark in the growth room. Okay, and the types of suspension culture. Batch culture is also another type of the culture. It is a type of suspension culture in which cells are grown in fixed volume of the nutrient medium. In most of the batch cultures, volume suspension is maintained between 100 to 50 ml. Here, increase in the density of the cell suspension is an indication of increase in biomass. Cell division and growth continues until the nutrient or oxygen controls the cessation of the cell growth. Here, the suspension culture is kept on a shaker, where a small aliquot of the inoculum is transferred to the fresh medium at regular intervals. Okay. The next one, continuous culture. The cells in suspension culture can be maintained for a considerable period of time by replacing with the fresh media and cell population. There are two types of continuous culture systems. One is closed continuous and the other one is open continuous culture system. In closed continuous culture system, the spent medium in the culture vessel is removed and outflow is balanced by inflow of fresh medium. In open continuous culture, inflow of fresh medium is balanced by outflow of spent medium of the same corresponding volume. The cells are harvested and replaced by fresh batch of cells. Right? Here, what happens in continuous culture? Large scale cultures can be grown under steady conditions. As the name suggests, continuous culture for long duration using this method, we are doing production of secondary metabolites. Fresh medium is added and used medium is drained out. Okay. Here you can see the pictorial representation of initiation and establishment of suspension culture. Here first we'll take high yielding plant variety, for example Lithospermum. From this plant, X plant was selected, that is young leaf, that from that young leaf plant cells were recovered. That young plant cells were subjected for the cell suspension culture. In the other way, instead of taking directly the plant cells. We can also go for the callus regeneration. From the callus, caliver taken, right, and that will be subjected for the cell suspension culture. Here the cell suspension cultures are derived from callus and cultured in liquid medium. When the friable callus is put in liquid medium and kept in shaker, the cells of the callus will get dissociated. Here usually 75 ml of the media is taken in 250 ml of flask, that the optimum inoculating density is 5 mg per 75 ml. The pH of the medium should be 5.6, and the flask is kept in a orbital shaker at 120 rpm, which is for the aeration of the medium, right? And the speed varies depending on the plant species, okay, based on the kind of experiment, that always varies, okay. That is about the cell suspension culture, and also cell culture in the bioreactor will be followed. Further, once the product formation occurs, then subjected to the product will be subjected for the downstream processing. Here downstream processing means you are going to purify the products without any kind of impurities, okay, without any cross contamination. You are going to extract the products, and that product further will be subjected for the packaging, right? Immobilized cell cultures. Imprisonment of plant cells for secondary metabolite production has several advantages. This can be used to prolong production phase, and thus product yield has been achieved. Entrapment of cells or tissue can be accomplished by variety of gel entrapment or encapsulation systems, in which different gel matrices like agar, gelatin, agarose, sodium alginate, cellulose and polysaccharides are employed. Several simple and non-toxic materials such as sodium alginate, polysaccharide, agar-agar, xanthan gum are used for cell immobilization. The technique is simple, cheap and gives high surface area to the volume ratio. The cells or cell aggregates can be imprisoned within the inert matrix, permitting easy flow of liquid media across the cells. Several bioreactors have been designed for accumulation of immobilized cells in gel matrix. Utility of fluidized flapped system is effective in maintaining entrapped cells. Okay, here you could see the different types of cell immobilization. Entrapment within the matrix, attachment or adsorption to a preformed carrier, self-aggregation of cells, cells contained behind a barrier. These are the different types of cell immobilization one can do this in the laboratory. Hope you have done the synthetic sets and immobilization of the yeast cell. That little bit knowledge will help you with this cell immobilization. To conclude about the immobilized cell culture, here the cells are physically immobilized by entrapment. Besides individual cells like protoplasts, which are isolated from the plant system by using enzymatic or chemical methods, also possible to immobilize aggregate cells or even calluses. The common entrapment methods are entrapment of cells in gels, in nets, foams, and entrapment of cells in hollow fiber membrane. Here you can see the overall advantages of cell suspension culture. This cell suspension culture provides better control for the scale-up of cell suspension cultures, constant regulations over the various stages of operation, reduced cost, easier handling of cultures such as inoculation or harvest is very simple and easy, shorter duration and continuous process when compared to the conventional method, enhanced uptake of nutrients in submerged cultures, easier production and scaling up of large number of plantlets will be easy, higher yield of bioactive compounds will be possible. Okay, here you could see the production of secondary metabolites by cell suspension culture. Okay, to perform the cell suspension culture, first you will select the explant. What do you mean by explant? The part of the plant used for culturing in vitro condition known as explant. Okay, why we are choosing explant or part of the plant? Because the part of the plant which has the totipotency characteristic. What do you mean by totipotency? The potential or ability of a plant cell to regenerate into a complete plantlet or whole plantlet is known as totipotency. Such type of cells, tissues, organs were taken and further subjected to callous condition. Okay, what do you mean by callous? Callous is the undifferentiated or unorganized mass of parenchymatous tissues. Okay, this callus will be induced in the tissue culture in vitro condition, and the further from this callus, small pieces of this callus was taken and subjected to the suspension culture and rotary shaker. Further, that will be subjected to large scale production process in the bioreactor. Okay, that is large scale suspension culture. Okay, hairy root culture. Hairy root culture, also called transformed root culture, and it is a type of plant tissue culture that is used to study plant metabolic processes or to produce valuable secondary metabolites or even recombinant proteins, and often with plant genetic engineering. Agrobacterium rhizogenes causes hairy root disease in plants. The neoplastic, just cancerous roots which are produced by Agrobacterium rhizogenes infection are characterized by high growth rate, genetic stability and growth in hormone free media. These genetically transformed root cultures can produce high levels of secondary metabolites when compared to that of intact plants. Then this is the picture representation of the hairy root culture under tissue culture condition. Okay, here you could see the biotechnological applications of hairy root research. First, the plant material will be selected which are of aromatic and medicinal importance. Then that will be subjected to in vitro culture of selected clones. Then the clones were subjected for the agrobacterium mediated gene transfer. Here we are using Agrobacterium rhizogenes, right, that will be infected with the plant tissues, right. You can see here the hairy roots. Then further these hairy roots will be isolated for the hairy root lines, then further subjected to screening for the hairy root lines. Then plant regeneration from hairy roots can be seen and will be able to obtain at the end scale up in bioreactor. Okay, here you can see hairy root culture in a solid and liquid media. It means the hairy root cultures can be performed in both liquid and solid culture. Let's see concluding part of hairy root culture. Here we used Agrobacterium rhizogenes, which is one of the example for indirect method of gene transfer by using root inducing plasmid, that is RI plasmid. Okay, hope you have studied in detail about Agrobacterium tumefaciens and their gene transfer methodology. Okay, that is the basic knowledge for this hairy root culture through Agrobacterium rhizogenes. Hairy roots are induced by genetic insertion of tDNA of RI plasmid lodged in Agrobacterium rhizogenes into wounded tissue, causing the growth of very fine adventitious roots. The wounded region produces a phenolic compound called acetosyringone, and this results in the chemotaxis with the bacteria. The release of this phenolic component like acetosyringone, which attracts the bacteria to get infected. Then the genes in the bacteria helps in the attachment to the plant cells, where which regions are involved in the transfer of tDNA into plant cell. T mean that is transfer DNA. That DNA will be transferred from the bacteria to the plant system. RI plasmid has transfer left and transfer right regions, each can induce root formation. Here you can see the advantages of hairy root culture. This hairy root culture play a very important role in enhancing the production of secondary metabolites through metabolic trapping, metabolic engineering and through elicitation. And also high growth rate and genetic stability will be possible through hairy root culture, which produce high levels of secondary metabolites and also produce stable levels of secondary metabolites over long time. And through this hairy roots culture, scaling up in plant bioreactor will be very simple and easy. Okay, now let's understand the bat transformation. Okay, bat transformation is one of the major thrust areas of biotechnological applications of plant cell and tissue culture. A suitable substrate is bat transformed to a desired product using plant cell. It is the production of the valuable products by plant cells in culture from cheap precursors which cannot be transformed by chemical or microbial systems. In addition, it is a novel approach to synthesize the substance of unknown structure and exhibits new pharmaceutical properties in cell culture. To brief you about this biotransformation, here the biotransformation using plant cell cultures we are doing. Okay, here what happens, the conversion of one chemical into another, that is the substrate will be converted into final product by using biological systems. Which is a biological system? Cell suspension. Here the cell suspension which act like a biocatalyst, which is regarded as biotransformation or bioconversion. In the exam you may get this question for 2 marks or 5 marks. You must be ready to write that particular answer. The biocatalyst may be free or immobilized, and the process of biotransformation may involve one or more enzymes. Okay, this is all about biotransformation. There are two approaches in biotransformation: to obtain novel compounds from substrates that are not normally available to the plants or products from other species. The second approach is to transform natural intermediates of important plant products. Example: digitoxin and digoxin are the two important pharmaceutical products extracted from Digitalis lanta, both of which are used in treatment of heart diseases. Therapeutically, digoxin is superior to digitoxin. Digitalis lanta, however, contains high level of digitoxin. Here, biotransformation of digitoxin to digoxin takes place by cell culture of Digitalis to several products. To brief you here, the biotechnological application of plant cell cultures in biotransformation reactions involves the conversion of some less important substance to valuable medicinal or commercial important products. In biotransformation, it is necessary to select such cell lines that possess the enzymes for catalyzing the desired reactions. Bioconversion may involve many types of reactions, for example, hydroxylation, reduction or glycosylation. A good example of biotransformation by plant cell cultures is the large scale production of cardiovascular drug, that is digoxin from digitoxin, by Digitalis lanta. Digoxin production is carried out by immobilized cells of digitoxin lanta in airlift bioreactors. Here, cell cultures of Digitalis or stevia plant species can convert steviole into stevobiocyte and stevocyte, which are 100 times sweeter than cane sugar. Okay, now let's go through product isolation. Sometimes the products are stored inside the cells while certain compounds are released into the medium. For intracellular product, cell wall is broken and the desired substance is precipitated by solvents or bound to suitable adsorbents. If the products are secreted into the medium is filtered. The obtained product is analyzed for its quality by HPLC, RIA, ELISA, spectrophotometer and other analytical techniques will be carried out here. Okay, now let's move on to the production of chicorin. Chicorin, a red naphthoquinone pigment or derivative extracted from a traditional Japanese or Chinese medicinal perennial herb. Example: lithospermum erythroisin, mainly from root pulp.
It has been found to possess a variety of biological activities, including strong wound healing, antibacterial property, anti-inflammatory and anti-tumor effects. Used for flavors, fragrances, pigments, dyes, cosmetics and food additives. In this production of chicorin, cell lines with higher pigment production were selected by cell aggregate cloning technique. I have already told in the previous slide that what do you mean by cell aggregate cloning technique. Many of the standard medium consists of ammonium ions, but ammonium is found to inhibit chicorin production. So here a dual culture protocol was designed for production of chicorin using M9 and MG5 medium. MG5 medium promoted cell growth but limited chicorin production. M9 medium promoted chicorin production but inhibited the cell growth. The cells are first grown in growth promoting medium designated as MG5 for 9 days in a 200 liter capacity airlift fermenter. The MG5 medium served as an efficient growth medium, filtered and pumped to a second vessel in which the M9 production medium is added. The cells are cultured for 14 additional days in, then after which they are recovered by filtration and the chicorin is extracted from the cells. It was estimated that the cell culture was 800 times more productivity than any other conventional method. Here you could see the mass production of chicorin where we use MG5 medium, then subjected to the cells to the tank 200 capacity of the liter for the 9 days in the airlift fermenter, then filtered, then subjected to the M9 medium, then again further subjected to the 750 liter airlift bioreactor for 14 days. Okay, then that will be filtered and cells were recovered. Okay, here you can see the overview of production of secondary metabolites. Okay, here we have taken the plant tobacco. This tobacco plant further subjected for the plant transformation by using Agrobacterium rhizo genes than transgenic plants. Here you can also go for the subculturing process. Subculturing can be done when the cells are in the exponential stage. The stage of development can be identified by growth pattern studies. What is this growth pattern studies? It is done for every 25 days from the day of starting. Okay, for studying growth different methods can be used. Optical density, dry weight, cell counting or packed cell volume can be considered. Okay, then from the transgenic plants further subjected to transgenic callus. Okay, in the other direction callus will be regenerated. From the callus, we can go for the cell suspension culture. When you go for the callus observation, we can also focus on different types of callus: nodular callus, friable callus, green callus and embryogenic callus. Friable callus is more preferred because of the loosely arranged cells. Culturing in suspension will be very easy. Okay, once cell transformation has happened, then further subjected to cell suspension culture, the cell culture in bioreactor for the large scale production. Okay, then finally will be going through downstream processing. Is nothing but the recovery of the product in a very purified form by using different analytical techniques. At the end, then we'll be able to obtain the products of the proteins which are obtained through through this plant tissue culture. Hope by now you have understood the in vitro production of secondary metabolites. Now let us understand the differences between the primary metabolites and the secondary metabolites. Primary metabolites are directly involved in body's basic metabolic reactions like normal growth, development, reproduction, etc. Whereas secondary metabolites are organic compounds synthesized by plants, fungus and microbes, and they are not essential part of metabolic pathway but as side products. Primary metabolites have definite defined role and functions in metabolism and are essential for growth and development. Whereas secondary metabolites not directly involved in growth and development, but they play very important role in ecological functions like defense, medicinal use, flavorings, etc. They can also be poisonous sometimes, not all the time, sometimes. So one should be very careful with the secondary metabolites production process. Examples: alcohol, amino acids, nucleic acids, vitamins, carbohydrates, etc. Under primary metabolites, I have written their nucleic acids. When you say nucleic acids, there you are going to differentiate nucleotide and nucleosides, right? There you can see the purines and pyrimidines, right? And those are also components of primary metabolites, which play a very important role in the growth and development, right? And also other examples like immunoglobulins, enzymes, plasma membrane, which comes under the primary metabolites, which are basically made up of proteins. Then secondary metabolites, some examples: pigments like anthocyanin, alkaloids like morphine, terpenoids, toxins, antibiotics, drugs like vinblastine, polymeric substances like rubber and gums. Okay, these secondary metabolites, which are produced by both plants, bacteria and fungi, these secondary metabolites which are required for the plant survival, right? And they also help in response to the stress. Now let us go through here the synthesized enzyme reaction through primary metabolites, then secondary metabolites. When you take a primary metabolites, we can different components play very important role in the metabolic pathways. For example, inorganic compounds, here we can take example phosphorus, nitrogen, sulfur, etc., responsible for the formation of amino acids, sugar, vitamins, etc. Then in turn, these primary metabolites will be further utilized for the production of the secondary metabolites like beta carotene, polyphenol, flavonoids, etc. Hope you have understood the concept of in vitro production of secondary metabolites. Thank you for watching. This is Dr. Pratibha KS signing out for today. Thank you, everyone.